Okay, people. Anytime. Okay, this is the first time that I will be meeting with you, and there will be some other times in the future. But today is going to be the first of three sessions on the lower extremity. And I would like to use this first session to give you a sense of the general organization of the lower extremity. And then as you begin to dissect, and in the next two sessions that will follow next week, we will kind of fill in some of the information. So there's going to be a few moments when you say, well, Jesus, so much information here, I can't catch it all. Just be aware that we are going to fill it in as we are moving along begin to go into the specific details of the dissection. I have the advantage that you already have looked at the upper extremity, and so a number of concepts are easily transferred. First of all, we have the general organization of the limb as far as the skeleton is concerned, and the components of the extremity. We have, as you know, an embedded portion, sometimes known as the girdle. And in the case of the lower extremity, of course, it's a pelvic girdle, not a pectoral girdle. And then in the free portion of the extremity, there are three parts. And same way, there were specific names like arm, forearm, hand. In the case of the lower extremity, the terms are the thigh, the leg, and the foot. So again, arm did not refer to the entire length of the extremity, and the same way, leg only refers to the part that is between the knee joint and the ankle joint. Now, the skeleton in these three components, again, follows a basic pattern. In the embedded portion, it is the bony pelvis, and the bony pelvis is composed of three fused bone, ilium, ischium, and pubic bone. And these three bones are connected to the central trunk skeleton by a very strong joint, the sacroiliac joint. Now, that is different from what you had in the upper extremity. In the upper extremity, the only articulation is the articulation between the clavicle and the sternum. And that's a very delicate articulation. And you can do without. If you remove the head of the clavicle, you can actually still function quite well. You have all of the fine ability to move still present. But of course, the sacroiliac joint is a major joint to support the weight of your body. And so it has to be strong, and it's a very fixed joint. Then there is the single bone, the proximal bone, which is the femur, parallel to the humerus in the upper extremity. Two intermediate bones, tibia and fibula. And then finally, in the foot, this whole clutter of bones, where in this case you don't have carpal bones, but you have tarsal bones. And again, the same kind of generalized series of five digits. So the general organization of the skeleton is really relatively simple and not a problem. I would now like to, as I'm beginning to lay out the organization of the extremity, I just want to familiarize you once again with the various axes of the extremity, and this is based on a developing limb, so you're looking at an embryonic developing limb, and what you're having is a series of axes in three dimensions. So there's one that is going along the length of the limb, that is the proximal distal axis. Then you have an axis that separates the limb into a dorsal and a ventral component. And that was the same. You had that in the upper extremity also. And finally, there is an axis that runs in this direction over here, which separates the limb into a preaxial and a postaxial component. Preaxial lying in front of the longitudinal axis, postaxial lying posterior to it. And these three subdivisions, these three axes with the way the limb is broken down, now are going to affect the different organizations. We begin with the muscle. The muscles are organized according to dorsal and ventral compartments. Now, it's very easy to understand dorsal and ventral compartments in this particular situation, which is diagrammed here. When you have an animal that has just come out of the water and goes on land, the dorsal surfaces of the limb are just continuous with the dorsal surface of the body. So it just kind of continues on like this, while the ventral surfaces are all located like this. And so that's very easy, but we don't walk like a crocodile, okay? We have kind of changed. And what we have done is we have turned our upper extremity in this direction with the elbow going backward, while we have turned our lower extremity in this direction forward with the knee joint going forward. And that change is affecting the way the muscles are organized. Now, in the case of the upper extremity, it's not a problem because it moves very freely. And so you can hold your upper extremity like this, and you say, okay, I'm looking at the ventral side, I'm looking at the dorsal side. No problem. You can reconstruct the ventral and the dorsal side quite easily. And so you know that ventral side has flexors, dorsal side has extensors, all of that relatively simple. In the lower extremity, because what you're doing there, you have a situation where you have to fix things in place, it's a little harder to reconstruct. So let's look at that. This is the series of diagrams from here to here, A and B, which shows you how you went from the crocodile arrangement to the general tetrapod arrangement. And you see how the knee joint is moving forward and the elbow joint is moving backward, and there are some other rotations going with it. And the same thing is true during our development. During development, we also go from the straight paddles that we start out with to these turned structures. And so again, here is the lower extremity. And what you'd have to realize is that because of those rotations, the dorsal surface of the lower extremity actually gets wrapped forward. Okay, so that when you're looking at the thigh, you're kind of in the middle of the turn, but most of the thigh, when you're looking at the anterior surface, is a dorsal compartment. And when you get below the knee in the leg, the anterior compartments are entirely dorsal. Okay, so that is something that you have to keep in mind. So this is the diagram. It's a beautiful picture, actually. You don't do dissections like this because you don't like to lose all the muscles. But it is a really wonderful dissection. It shows you how you can, in fact, if you remove all the muscles from the compartment, you can visualize the compartment. I know you've seen them in the upper extremity, so I don't have to spend the whole deal of time with it. But the muscle compartments are separated by these tough septa, in connective tissue septa. And so you can see here the structures inside that dorsal compartment. So the dorsal compartment that you see on the thigh, anterior compartment, is the primitively dorsal compartment. Okay, so now that we understand that basic statement, let's look for a moment at how it looks in a cross-section. This is medial, this is lateral. Keep that in mind. Anterior over here, posterior over there. Fine. Now you can draw a line. See, the compartments are separated on this diagram by these blue lines, which are these connective tissue septa. And so you can say, all right, everything over here, where the big X is, that is a primitively dorsal compartment. That's the anterior compartment of the thigh, but it is primitively dorsal. And on this side, you have two compartments, the medial compartment that you're also going to start dissecting today, and another compartment, which is the posterior compartment. And those two are continuations of the ventral compartments. So dorsal on this side, ventral on this side in the thigh. Now, the reason why this is important is that, I mean, you know, you could say, well, that those are just terms. I don't worry too much about the terms. But the reason why it is important is because of the way the nerves of final distribution in the extremity are actually arranged. And so what you find is that the development of dorsal and ventral muscle groups is associated with the development of the nerves that grow along with them as they begin to develop in the extremity. And what you're seeing here is an interesting diagram. It shows two groups of muscles, dorsal extensors and ventral flexors. And as they grow out in a proximal distal direction, they carry with them nerve fibers. And the further distal you come, the lower the spinal cord segment is that carries fibers to the more distal components. So you have a situation here where you, first of all, you have, number one, the need to innervate the muscles via the anterior and the posterior divisions of the nerves from the plexus, Again, there is a plexus here, and so you need anterior and posterior divisions, which will give innervation to the ventral and to the dorsal compartments. So that is the first thing that happens. But now number two is, as you go proximo-distally, you get, in the proximal part, you get a higher spinal cord segment. So say, for example, in the case of the lower extremity, you start with L2. If you go a little bit further out, it becomes L3 that is carried in, then you get L4. And as you go further distally, you just go down. So as you are developing more muscles further along the proximo-distal axis, you get lower spinal segment fibers that innervate those muscles. So that is an important consideration that you need to have as you are looking at the innervation of these compartments. And then there is another issue, and that is the issue of the dermatomes, the afferent, general somatic afferent groups of fibers. And the pattern of the dermatomes is indicated here on an anterior surface and a posterior surface. And what you're seeing here, it is very much like the wrapping that you saw before, but now you see that you go from L2 to L3 to L4, and see how the dermatomes are kind of wrapped around again. Then L5, S1, S2, S3. Okay, so that is the pattern of the dermatomal distribution. Interestingly, if you look closely, and you can just see that here, you see that there is a gap, L2 here, S3 here. There are a few dermatomes missing on the surface of the trunk. And that becomes important and interesting when you're seeing it, when you do actually the dissection next week of the gluteal region. What you find is that there are nerves that you see here, the superior clunial nerves, which just means buttock nerves. Sometimes the Latin sounds much nicer than the English. And so they come from L1, in this case L1 to 3, but that, you know, the difference between the previous picture you saw and this is, of course, that there is this overlap of dermatomes. So that, don't worry too much about that. But then you have a couple missing, and then you get to the next group of nerves, middle clunials, that are S1 and S3. So again, there is this gap. There are certain dermatomal segments that are not represented on the trunk. And then, of course, this inferior clunial, which comes directly from the plexus and supplies most posterior surface of the thigh. And not surprisingly, that would also be S1 to S3. Okay, this particular picture does not show what actually happens developmentally, but it's kind of neat because what it shows you is here is a group of dermatomes starting with L2 and going to S3, I think, hard to read. And so in this direction, so this is obviously more rostral, this is more caudal. And you see that, it, you know, theoretically, every dermatome is represented in this particular diagram. And then as the limb begins to develop, you see that certain dermatomes lose connection. L3, L4. This one also indicates S1, and then you go and you get these again are represented on the body wall, but there's this gap in between where you don't have these dermatomal segments present. The typical thing that we are saying, now come and listen, that second axis gets into the story, and that is that if this is the head and this is the tail, this would be the axis of the limb, and so we call this the preaxial surface, and this the post-axial surface, okay? It's just, if you imagine that you are a quadruped and you're walking down the street that way, the part that is on the head side is pre-axial and the part on your tail end is the post-axial. Good. So, when you now look at a cross-section of the limb, what we have just discussed is there is a dorsal compartment, which is anterior in the lower extremity, the ventral compartments, and then you have a pre-axial border, and a post-axial. And what you see in here is two sets of requirements that the nerves that are going to the limb must meet. Okay, you have to have the dermatomal innervation along pre- and post-axial distribution, and you have the muscle innervation, which follows this dorsoventral arrangement. So that's where the plexus comes in, okay? We have, this is kind of a general diagram, but of course in the case of the upper extremity, you had the brachial plexus. Now you're going to have the lumbosacral plexus. And what happens is, as you already know, in a plexus, at each spinal cord level, you have a dorsal root with a ganglion, you have a ventral root, motor root. They two combine in a short segment that is known as a spinal nerve, and then there is a separation. There's a couple of posterior rami that are not involved in the plexus, and in fact, the superior and middle clunial nerves that you saw on the buttock are these posterior rami. But then the anterior ramus of each spinal nerve now starts to contribute into the plexus. And I just kind of put this as a big gray oval because, you know, lots of things happens in the plexus. And what comes out at the other end are nerves that are either belonging to the posterior or the anterior division. When you talk posterior division, you're talking about dorsal, the primitively dorsal group. Anterior division is primitively ventral. Okay. So these divisions that come out of the plexus immediately, they are routed to either primitively dorsal or primitively ventral surfaces. But of course, this is other. You really are distributing and packaging a whole series of fibers from different spinal cord levels and doing these different things in the distribution. So let's now look. What you are going to have is you have the lumbosacral plexus formed from the anterior primary rami of nerves L2 to S3. And now the plexus is a distribution center, which is going to give rise to the afferent nerves, preaxial, postaxial, the efferent nerves, dorsal, ventral, and you also have to take into account the proximal distal organization. And it is a miracle that what happens now, what you're getting, is a group of nerves of final distribution, four of them that are important in the lower extremity, okay? So what you see here now is the actual lumbosacral plexus nicely graphed out. You're seeing actually L1 a little bit, mostly L2, L3, L4, that is the lumbar plexus. Then you have sacral plexus, S1, S2, S3, and you have this trunk, the lumbosacral trunk, which is a combination of L4, L5 that joins the sacral plexus. Also, it contributes to the lumbar plexus from L4 level at least. So that is the basic set of fibers that contributes to the plexus. What comes out are a group of nerves of terminal distribution, and those are the femoral nerve and the obturator nerve. That is from the lumbar plexus, L2, L3, L4. And those nerves, because they are coming from the lumbar plexus, are going to innervate the more proximal part of the extremity. So in the case of the thigh, the muscles of the thigh are going to be innervated by L2 through L4 from those two nerves. Okay, femoral, primitively dorsal in black, obturator, primitively ventral in a lighter shade. Let's move on a little bit further down, because now we get into the remainder of the plexus, where you have the lumbosacral trunk and the sacral plexus. And now what you the levels that you have represented, L4, L5, S1, S2, S3, that now, those levels are going to give rise to the primitively dorsal, which is now known as the common fibular nerve. So it is no longer the peroneal, it's a common fibular nerve and the tibial nerve. And those two very large nerves, again, primitively dorsal is black, primitively ventral is lighter stained. Those two nerves, because of the fact that they are L4 through S3, will be further distal in the lower extremity. And that's where they will innervate the muscles. There are a couple of other nerves that you're seeing here. Here, here, here. These are kind of cute little nerves, and we'll come to those in a moment. Okay, so the major nerves of the lower extremity. Let's now lay it out for you. Primitively dorsal, posterior divisions, femoral nerve, common fibular nerve. And then again, primitively ventral, obturator nerve, more proximal, tibial nerve, more distal. The tibial and the common fibular nerve start out running together, and they are known as the sciatic nerve. And that is one of the really huge nerves of the body. Okay, you're going to enjoy dissecting that. Okay, so let's now see how these nerves get into the lower extremity. They come from the pelvis. They have to come from the area where the lumbosacral plexus is, and that will be located in this area. And so they have to now leave the bony pelvis to innervate the different parts of the lower extremity. And you're seeing here a series of places where they can exit, the obturator foramen right here, the space underneath the inguinal ligaments over here. And then there are two foramina, which are really huge foramina, and they are known as the sciatic, the greater sciatic foramen and the lesser sciatic foramen. They are actually made into foramina by these large fibers, the sacrospinal ligament that runs from the pelvic bone to the sacrum, and the sacrotuberous ligament, which is right over here. Okay. So that then makes these two larger openings, the greater sciatic foramina and the lesser sciatic foramina. So those are the places where the nerves and the blood vessels can enter the extremity. And you're seeing that graphically illustrated here. I'm not going to talk about the particular nerves just yet, because next week you're going to really see them in more detail. But you just need to know that that those are the places where these nerves and blood vessels come into the region. Okay, I'm just going to briefly talk about the gluteal region because it is somewhat a unique area. It's sometimes confusing because, you know, the gluteal region, the area with around the hip joint and the buttocks, it is lying for us kind of on top of the lower extremity. And what you really have to consider is, if you have to understand how the innervation is taking place, is that it is by the sacral plexus. And the reason for that is that in a quadrupedal position, it's a kind of a ridiculous picture, but the point is that the gluteal region actually lies more caudal than the rest of the lower extremity. Okay, and that's the point that you have to keep in mind. All right. So, when you look at where the nerves come from that are going to innervate the gluteal region, they come from the lumbosacral plexus, from the more distal part. And there are some specific nerves, this one over here and this one over here, the posterior end, that are going to supply the superficial muscles of the gluteal region, while there are some other nerves on the anterior division that are going to supply the deeper muscles of the gluteal region. The reason then is that you have to understand that when you start dissecting the gluteal region, you actually have two layers of muscles, and the more superficial muscles are posterior and the deeper muscles are anterior. And so the anterior and posterior divisions take care of these respective areas. So anterior division goes to the deeper muscles, posterior divisions go to the superficial muscles. Once you get that point, it's really no big deal, okay? So basically then, and you know, just say, okay, I know the information is there, it's here. Don't bother right now going into it in detail, but these are the muscles that are lying on the superficial region, that is the primitively dorsal group, posterior division, and the deeper muscles are innervated by the anterior division. And just so that you get the idea, when you first hit the gluteal region, you start with the gluteus maximus, and underneath it is the gluteus medius, and then underneath that is the gluteus minimus. And then there's another muscle, a large muscle here, that's known as the piriformis muscle, and there's a muscle on the outside, tensor fasciae latae. That is for next week, okay? Those are the fine details that you are going to look at. But you're seeing how the first layer, once you remove that, you come to the second layer, and those are these four muscles that you see here, the two gemelli, obturator, internus, and quadratus femoris. It's really fairly simple, straightforward. And when you start dissecting, the key that you have to use is that there's one muscle coming out of the greater sciatic foramen, the piriformis, and everything kind of comes out underneath and above it. And so once you start dissecting it, if you just hit for the piriformis muscle, the whole dissection just unfolds like nobody's business, okay? And including the very large sciatic nerve that you're seeing here, okay, that comes out underneath it. Okay, the details for next week, we worry about it next week. Just here a little picture of that great sciatic nerve, and you realize that it is lying amidst the very large muscles known as the hamstring muscles. So just kind of a preview of that posterior thigh compartment with the hamstring muscles. Okay, this is another picture that is graphic enough, but what you why do I hear nervous laughter? Okay, never mind. What you have to realize is that when you do the dissection, there is a certain amount of locations where these blood vessels and nerves come from, and you want to avoid those. So there is, in fact, a safe area in the upper lateral quadrant of the gluteal region where you can safely put an injection needle without damaging any of these structures. So that's one thing that you really have to, you know, that it's a good practical thing to know. Okay, good. Now, just a brief moment to talk about the blood vessels that leave the pelvis, and then we are going into the actual compartments and put all the pieces together. The blood vessels that you are going to see in the lower extremity, again, it's really extremely simple, as long as you keep the organization in mind. There is a very large blood vessel, which is a distinct continuation of the external iliac artery, which you will encounter later on, and that is known as the femoral artery. Okay, so that is going to go into the anterior compartment, and you're going to see that in a moment. Then, inside the pelvis, this blood vessel, the common iliac artery, actually breaks up into an external and internal. But what you have, the only thing that you right now need to know is that from that other, the internal iliac, you get all of the other blood vessels that you are concerned with. The superior gluteal artery over here, and it's actually better over here, you can see it right, much better. The inferior gluteal artery, which is over here, and then another smaller artery, known as the obturator artery, which is going to the obturator foramen and enters the second compartment that we are dissecting today. So, now let's put the nerves and the blood vessels together, okay? Because each compartment has its own unique pattern of innervation and vascularization. It's very easy to remember, and you don't have to worry a lot more about it. In this case here, lateral is here and medial is here, okay? And again, I can draw the line and say, okay, this is the primitively dorsal on this side, which is this is the anterior compartment. And the anterior compartment has as its principal nerve supply, the motor nerve supply, the femoral nerve, L2 through L4, and its principal blood vessel is the femoral artery and its branches. But that's basically, that's what it is. So femoral nerve, femoral artery, big, no problem. And that takes care of all the motor innervation to the muscles of this compartment. And here is now what is known as Hilton's law. It's one of those awkward little laws that we know about. Once the motor fibers have been given up by these nerves of final distribution, the nerve continues as an afferent nerve, a sensory nerve. And now it supplies sequentially the dermatomes that it is also responsible for. So while the motor nerves basically take care of the muscles in the thigh, the motor fibers, the sensory fibers actually travel much further down all the way to the ankle and supply L2, L3, L4 dermatomes. So that is something that continues and is known as saphenous nerve. Okay, the second group of blood vessels, so this is the femoral nerve seen from posterior. The second group of blood vessels basically is formed by the deep artery of the thigh, or deep femoral artery also known, which has branches around the joint, lateral and medial circumflex. But the branches I want to highlight now for you are these. Those are the so-called perforating branches. So while the deep artery of the thigh is going to supply the medial compartment, the adductor compartment that you're seeing here, that is this area right here, the perforating arteries actually are going to go through here and supply the other posterior compartment. So now let's look at this adductor compartment, posteromedial. This is again, it's medial, this is lateral. And it is supplied by, first of all, the obturator nerve. That's the second nerve that came from the lumbar plexus. And the blood vessel is the deep femoral artery. And finally, the third compartment, the posterior compartment of the thigh, is supplied by the tibial nerve largely. While the common fibular nerve runs in that compartment, only one little muscle right here is going to be supplied by it, and I will explain that to you later why that is. But the tibial nerve is the principal nerve of this compartment, and the blood vessels of this compartment actually come as the perforating branches of the deep femoral artery. So they come from the adjacent compartment into this compartment. Okay? So basically what you can say is by having defined each of these compartments, you know which the nerves are that supply these compartments, and you know the principal blood vessels that take care of them. All right, now let's look at the dissection and start out. The first thing that we are looking at when we dissect the anterior compartments is, of course, what you see after you have removed the skin. And basically what you find is a very large lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, which kind of comes like here, and that runs over much of the surface of the thigh. And then there are cutaneous branches of the femoral nerve that are joining this particular group. So that is the first set of nerves that are taking care of the afferent supply. One minor point, if you see where this nerve comes from, it comes from below the inguinal ligament. And the inguinal ligament can sometimes be pressed upon the structures that pass underneath it if you are particularly heavy set. So a particularly heavy gentleman, kind of a robust, corpulent person, may find that they actually are pressing on the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, and they begin to have a little discomfort, a little nerve issues. You know, they're aware that it is beginning to irritate, and that is generally a very good reason to start convincing them that they might want to lose some weight. Okay, so anyway, all right. The other part that you want to see here is the large vein that lies on the outer surface of the investing fascia that sits around all of the muscles. And this large vein is known as the great saphenous vein. Okay? And that great saphenous vein can be followed all the way to the ankle joint. It's the vein that you use to cut down and insert a cannula in if you need to. And that great saphenous vein runs up all the way here, and then through a opening in that investing layer, it goes deep and joins the femoral vein that drains the deeper layers of the extremity. And you see that here very nicely, the great saphenous vein joining through that saphenous ring, that ring in that investing fascia, and then it joins that deeper femoral vein that lies underneath. So that is something that you want to pay attention to before you start removing the fascia. Now, this is typical investing fascia, heavy. It's a supportive structure, and as a result, it's called the fascia lata. This is a very thick fascial layer. Once you cut into that thick fascial layer and start looking at the muscles underneath, you now get the full view of the components of the anterior compartment. And the first thing that you identify, and it's important because when you start talking to each other and you have to communicate, you sometimes have to indicate something like the femoral triangle, just to indicate where you are. This is the femoral triangle. The femoral triangle is formed by the inguinal ligament on the top, the medial border of the sartorius muscle. The sartorius muscle is this muscle that kind of wraps around, and the lateral border of the adductor longus. We'll go into that in a moment, but that's the basic thing. Here in a simple diagram, you see here the medial border of the sartorius, lateral border of the adductor longus, inguinal ligament. That is the triangle, the boundary of the triangle. The floor of the triangle is formed by two muscles. And one of them is the pectineus muscle, which is a part of the medial compartment. And the other one is a muscle that kind of joins the anterior compartment here, but comes underneath the inguinal ligament. And that is the combined muscle known as the iliopsoas muscle. It comes from inside the pelvic bone and then crosses into this compartment over here. What is inside the femoral triangle are the major neurovascular structures. So color-coded, the yellow, of course, is a nerve. That is the femoral nerve. And typically, it is kind of tied to the iliopsoas, the iliacus part of the iliopsoas, with another fascia. But the other structures, the femoral artery, the femoral vein, and some lymphatics, are traveling more medial to that and go from the pelvis into the thigh. And so here now, after you remove the neurovascular bundle, you actually see this whole thing. And what you now get mostly is the contents, muscular contents in this particular view of the anterior thigh. And here you see the muscular contents. The sartorius muscle, okay, starts all the way in the lateral side, wraps in front and inserts medial to the knee joint, and just a little bit below the knee joint. Sartorius muscle, named after tailors. Tailors used to sit in a certain position that would actually stretch this muscle and kind of strengthen it along the way. And so in tailors, that sartorius muscle was always very well developed, which is why it was named after them. Then you have the quadriceps femoris. Now, quadriceps femoris means, first of all, that it's a femoral group of muscles. That's fine. That is self. That's understood. But it has four heads, and the four heads are seen here. It has a rectus femoris, and then it has a series of large bellies. Lateral, intermediate, and medial bellies are present. The only muscle from these four that is actually going to act on the hip joint, as we will see in a moment, is the rectus femoris. And then there is the tensor fascia latae, which actually is built into that heavy fascia that you have cut into, and that runs on the lateral surface. And that is basically all, and this, of course, is the iliopsoas that we mentioned before. Those are the muscles that you're going to dissect. It's not very challenging, okay? This is okay. You can do that. Now, let's look at what happens to the neurovascular bundle. We kind of ignored it in the previous view. And what you're seeing now is how, after the motor fibers have been given up, that you're seeing here, this nerve now continues to follow with the blood vessels, the femoral artery and the femoral vein. And for a while, these structures are literally housed in a fibrous tunnel. And that is known as the adductor canal. It's lying anterior to the adductor muscles. After a while, that adductor canal ends up in this opening here. This is the large adductor group. Dr. Magnus, the tendon is over here, and there is an opening between the tendon and the rest of the muscle, and the blood vessels actually are going to go through this opening, and after they leave this area, they go to the posterior area of the knee joint, where popliteal become the popliteal vessels. We'll pick them up there next week, so they become popliteal artery and vein, okay? So the femoral artery and vein go into the adductor canal, then literally through this adductor opening and to the posterior surface. What stays anteriorly is the saphenous nerve. That is that remainder of the femoral nerve that carries the afferent fibers. That's going to go all the way down along the medial side of the leg to the ankle joint. So we have done, or you are going to do, you are going to do the dissection of the anterior compartment, and then you're going to follow that with the dissection of the adductor compartment. And the abductor has a group of muscles associated with it, the pectineus muscle over here. And then you have the adductor longus. Now, the adductor longus is not shown in position here because this is a reflected adductor longus. One part is here and this other part over here. But that's the adductor longus, which is the first one to see on the surface. Then underneath it, the adductor brevis. If you have a separate muscle, not always present, underneath the adductor brevis, there may be even an adductor minimus, a very small adductor. And finally, all the rest of this here is adductor magnus. The only thing that I need to add to that is the gracilis muscle, which is lying like a ribbon on the medial edge of this adductor compartment. Oh, here's a very pretty picture, it's somewhat fanciful, but very pretty. And what you're seeing here is, on one side, you see the more superficial muscles, the pectineus, running to the pectineal ridge of the pubic bone. And then you have the adductor longus, nice big muscles. And once you remove these, then you get underneath the adductor longus, now full view of the adductor brevis. And, of course, underneath here you find the adductor magnus with that adductor foramen where the blood vessels went through. And, of course, the other little holes here are the perforating arterial entrance to the posterior compartment. So, again, like the piriformis muscle, if you know the trick, in the case of the gluteal region, you go and pick out the piriformis muscle. Once you identify it, you find all the nerves and arteries very prettily. And in the case of the adductor compartment, what you want to look for is the adductor brevis muscle, which you now will find all of the branches of the obturator nerve. Some of them run anterior to them, going to the anterior parts, anterior muscles of the compartment, and then there are posterior branches going to the posterior part. So that's fine. Just a pretty picture of the tensor fasciae latae, worth doing a little careful dissection of, but very not to be worried about. Okay. The final few minutes of this particular session we will spend on the hip joint, okay? I'll come back to it next time when you know a little bit more of the muscles, because then you can kind of put the pieces together. But let's now first talk principle. The hip joint is a diarthrodial joint, meaning that it has a synovial cavity. And the joint is formed by this concave compartment of the pelvic bone, which is where the three bones actually come together, ilium, ischium, and pubic bone, all contribute to that particular surface. And the second component of the joint, of course, is the head of the femur. And these, typically when you look at a section, this is a fresh section, you see that the articulating surfaces are covered with articular cartilage. It's usually hyaline cartilage, and that is shown here in white. So you can clearly see what the articulating surfaces are. On the periphery of the joint, you see a fibrous, dense fibrous capsule, which literally keeps all of the synovial fluid from running all over the place, but also strengthens the support of the joint. This is kind of a crazy picture, but I like it because it shows you the two components that surround the joint. The articular capsule, shown in pink here, and the synovial membrane in blue. The synovial membrane contains the cells that produce the synovial fluid and also do housekeeping on the synovial fluid, kind of macrophages to remove some of the synovial fluid when it needs to go. And this is actually the two components of the joint. And what you're seeing here, if you listen to me closely in the previous two slides, what you're seeing here is a blue surface. Of course, that is only for graphic purposes. But what you on the convex side, what you're seeing is that is only a kind of a half moon-like structure. It's known as the lunate surface. That is the part that is involved in articulation. Okay, the rest here, the acetabular fossa, really is not covered with articular cartilage and therefore is not really involved in the articulation. So the head of the femur, this round head that you're seeing here, articulates with this part. That's where the articulation occurs. The other thing that you see in here, this particular opening underneath the ligament that completes the fossa, that is the place where blood vessels come in, and there is actually a little ligament of the head of the femur that contains a little supply of blood vessels that go to the head of the femur. And if that particular ligament gets damaged, you can end up with necrosis of the head of the femur. Okay. Concept of joints is as follows. First of all, in the case of the hip joint, what you have is a ball and socket joint. And a ball and socket joint means that it can move in all three axes of space, and therefore you have an almost limitless number of directions in which you can move. But we maintain three axes of rotation for the sake of description. And what you find is that that joint movements are generally rotations, which means that they are rigid body movements around an axis of rotation. And this axis of rotation here is indicated in brown. You have a lever arm on one side of the axis of rotation, a lever arm here. And around this axis of rotation, you can rotate the lever arms if you have the right kind of tension being placed on it. And so if you have muscles running anterior to this axis of rotation that you're seeing, then you can have flexion. If there is a muscle running posterior to that axis of rotation, this lever arm will go down and you have extension. Okay, understand the basic principle. Axis of rotation is simple enough. Maximally, a diathyroidal joint can have three axes of rotation and therefore three pairs of rotation. And also it can have three pairs of possible translations, and we call that the total is a total of 6 degrees of freedom. Three rotations, three pair of translations. This is done on the basis of a vertebral column. Just to illustrate it, I'm going to have to look for a better picture than that because I really don't like it. So, okay, goodbye. All right, hip joint. Ball and socket joint has three axes of rotation. Let's just look at the three axes of rotation. You have a vertical axis of rotation right here. You have a transverse axis of rotation. And then you have an anteroposterior axis of rotation. Those are the three possible axes of rotation of this ball and socket joint. And now what I've indicated around each of these axes is what kind of pair of motions occurs around them. So if you have a transverse axis of rotation, this one over here, flexion and extension occur around that axis, okay? So I didn't bring all my toys with me, but maybe next time I'll do it. Because if you have a vertical axis of rotation, flexion, extension, flexion, extension. Okay, and you can understand, when you go sit down, you kind of flex the hip joint. Stand up, you extend the hip joint. The anteroposterior axis is an axis around which you can have this motion, which is abduction, and you can have this motion with this adduction. Ad always going to the central axis of the body, abduction moving away from it. And finally, you have this vertical axis, and the vertical axis allows for medial rotation, one direction, or lateral rotation. Okay, those are the three pairs of motions of the hip joint. Now, the simple thing to remember is, first of all, you have to, of course, realize that to move a hip joint, a muscle has to attach either on the pelvic bone or on the body wall. And the next location will have to be at least the femur or sometimes a little beyond that. But the thing is that you have to have a muscle that is attached above the area of the hip joint to affect the hip joint. But after that, what you need to know is that muscle has to cross the axis of rotation. In other words, if there's an axis of rotation like this, the muscle can either pass in front of it or pass behind it, but if it crosses at an angle, it acts on the axis. Okay? So now let's look, and I'm going to just show you a series of very simple diagrams after I'm just going over the ligaments, and then we'll finish for today, but I just want you to have that basic concept, and then as you start dissecting, start thinking about, okay, which muscle is actually working on the hip joint? And today you're going to look at the quadriceps femoris, and you're going to realize that only the one head of the quadriceps femoris, and not the other vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, etc., but only the rectus femoris is acting on the hip joint because it attaches to the pelvis. All the other muscles attach lower down, and they do not affect the hip joint. They're going to work on the knee joint. Okay? So, what you have around the joint, you have a series of ligaments to strengthen the joint capsule, and they are very nicely divided. I like didactic arrangements. Iliofemoral, going from the ilial part of the pelvic bone to the femur. It's like an inverted V, as I indicated here. Strong, since it lies anterior to the hip joint, it resists extension. The pubofemoral, this ligament right here, resists this motion, resists abduction. Whenever you put a ligament under tension, that is the motion that it will resist. And finally, the ischiofemoral ligament with the zona orbicularis resists medial rotation. I never thought I have to resist medial rotation, but I guess you do. And also keeps joint components together. Okay, now we're going to have a series of jolly pictures, and then we'll finish up with this. This one always cheers me up. You're seeing here all the muscles that potentially can produce hip flexion. The critical muscles that you should know about are rectus femoris, the sartorius, because the sartorius, even though it kind of crosses over, it does insert above the hip joint, and it lies anterior to the transverse axis. The iliopsoas, which is this muscle right here, and the pectineus, which is part of the adductor compartment. Okay, hip extension. Any muscle that runs posterior to the transverse axis. And the ones that you see in here, very nicely, the gluteus maximus, you know, that's known as sitzfleiss in traditional German things, which is not my own language, but I do enjoy that term. So the gluteus maximus is an extensor of the hip joints, which actually is able to allow us to get up from the seated position. The hamstrings, clearly, and those are the hamstrings, and they are really more used for extension when you climb stairs. Adduction, well, big deal. You just saw a whole adductor group, okay? Any muscle that is called adductor, by definition, has to be involved in the adduction of the hip joint, so that's fine. And then here, the abduction, which would be this group of muscles here. Notice that there's one fine point you're going to see later on. The gluteus medius and minimus, which are involved in abduction, are functioning in a different way than the gluteus maximus, which is involved in extension. And if you understand the way these fibers run, you will appreciate how they act on the different axes. A point that I will come back to, because I really want to get out of here, is... sorry, that wasn't meant as it sounded, okay. What you see here is this interesting picture that shows you abduction and adduction, but of course we don't do a whole lot of that in our daily lives. Basically what we are doing is we are using abduction and adduction in a different way to move our body weight in different positions. And so what if you have abduction in this direction, can also be done by having abduction of the pelvis. And if you have abduction of the pelvis, you have the same kind of motion, but your leg can stay on the ground, which is kind of nice. Okay, medial rotation is a weak motion, and you can see the numbers. You can look at these and kind of get the idea. And finally, lateral rotation, and all the muscles that you are going to dissect in the gluteal regions which show this. Final picture. Final picture here is the sartorius muscle, which is kind of a really cool muscle because what it does, it flexes the hip joint, it abducts, and it laterally rotates. Now, you know, how many things can one muscle do? So it literally acts on all of these different axes of rotation. And you see here the motion that the sartorius makes, and that was, of course, the position of the tailors that made that such an important muscle for tailors. Okay, I have had fun. I hope you had too, and I'll see you next week.